Two letters from the South Iberian alphabet. This one, it looks like an arrow, and two parallel lines here with two dots in it. And this looks like ogham strokes that goes with this inscription. And right here is a very interesting symbol. In the ogham, two strokes above the stem line is a D, and the word for God in Celtic is D-I-A, and generally the I-A sound is made with a cross like this, but in this case we have the D, and I don't think there's any doubt but what this is a Christian cross. Therefore, the writer of this symbol here has transformed what ordinarily would be a sign that would be a veil sign into a sign of the Christian faith. And right here, is a stem line. The person who wrote this ogham here was using some of these iron ore hard lines through here as a stem line, because you can see the strokes as they were carved down through this. I'm pretty sure this is an ogham inscription. And here we have the pentagram and other writing connected with it, and we're not sure what that means. We'll have to leave that up to the experts to decipher that. Now here we have a Phoenician bell inscription. Right here is the way the B can be made, like this. Here's the B, and here's the L, reading from left to right. And here is the bell inscription written in ogham. The B and the two strokes, the L. And there's a pretty good case that this could stand for the house of Baal or the temple of Baal.
Isn't it true that usually we're on a high hill here? They would come to a place such as this, a location to worship, and this is a perfect sacrifice area too for someone of Baal worship. And some Christians might wonder, well, why are you carrying out Baal signs? Why are you bringing them out? The simple fact is, it's true they were here. It documents they were here. And actually, there's nothing new under the sun, right, Jim? We've got them today. You have both Christian and Baal worshipers present. Their Baal worship today might be sacrificing to usury or automobile or whatever they put between them and God.
Right.
And some actually worshiping Satan, mm-hmm. practically. So truth is truth. And we have to document these things as they are, not changing anything, in a quest for truth of how the migrations were, that not only the good migrated, that's obvious today because of what's here. So this is wonderful, isn't it?
That's right. We're not trying to verify the Bible. It doesn't need verification.
That's right.
But it is compatible with what the scriptures teach.
Absolutely.
Because the book of Jeremiah and other prophets teach that the northern tribes were removed because of their worship of Baal.
That's right.
And the Assyrians took them away in 721, transported them over in the land of the Medes, and they were destined to be wanderers among the nations.
It was history, it was prophetic, and it's obvious that it happened. Here you have absolute proof.
This is eyewitness documentation.
Right. And again, there's nothing new under the sun. In this past week, the Church of England, which is a respected church today, but we all know at the same time it was the reason that the pilgrims left. Own worship, that is to say, to get away from a state-owned church. And this past week, the Church of England decided that due to so many complaints that it was out of touch with today's world, that they're even beginning to advertise themselves for to draw attention to their church. So migrations have been a part of man is a wanderer. And why? Well, we could say biblically because God prophesied that's right. Exactly what he was going to do to them. And when you're in Clay County, Kentucky, and anyone with a trained eye can see that these particular letters and also the drawing, the pictograph, that they are very ancient. And there is a little graffiti on the top of this hill, but that does not anyone, even a layperson, can judge the difference between something that's 50 years old, 100 years old, by the type of lettering used. EB loves LJ or plus LJ. We know that's not a cross. It's modern. That practice has not been used for a great period of time. So it is exciting, and it's anxious. I'd like to say something else. Many people might wonder, well, why do you do these documentaries for a Christian network? You would be surprised how many people have been drawn to the Word of God by documenting, even in our own nation and the world, that the Bible is true, the history that is recorded. We see the migrations because the stones speak. This was their newspaper. This was their tabloid of that time. For in this particular case, and I'm sure this was used by other people other than Baal worshipers at one time or the other, but this was obviously a stone for sacrifice, or considered to be a temple of Baal at one time here in Clay County, Kentucky. Very good, Jim.
I believe, Arnold, that this should not be wasted. This should be mentioned because the seed of Abraham were called to be the oracle people. They were the ones chosen to speak for God, weren't they?
That's very true.
And if they didn't do it willingly, they're going to do it unwillingly. He's going to speak through these people, even through their disobedience.
Very true.
And here we have the sign of the Baal worshipers, and it verifies the fact that even without them knowing it, they are speaking God's word. It shows that God promised that he would scatter. He promised that he would, he said, you'll not be my people. I'll no longer have mercy upon you. They're speaking.
Absolutely. And anytime you find a word in two different alphabets, it gives you the length of time. I would say that the Ogham Baal, as it is here, was certainly no more recent, because there's no vowels involved, the type of Ogham that was used no later than 800 A.D. So we're talking about back. Personally, if I were to make an educated guess, I would say it's older than that, even. So
I think it's wonderful, Arnold, that you and I could stand here in a positive way and preach willingly God's Word, where our ancestors once stood in ignorance, and they were still his oracle people. And God is still demonstrating, even through their disobedience, his truth.
Absolutely. And so, when you see one of these ancient signs, never destroy it with graffiti, or try to help protect it. There's very few, though at the same time there are many, that many have been destroyed. So respect the heritage and preserve that is ancient, so that your children, if the Lord should tarry, will be able to see these beautiful things, these things that speak so much better and oftentimes than a history book. A history book simply is his story. That's what the word history means, his story. But when you see the actual fact that they were here, then that becomes an actuality. That is a fact, and that is truth. So, there you have it. Here we are on a mountaintop in Clay County, Kentucky, Baal, which is to say God to some, two different alphabets. Fascinating. Well, let's move on and see what else you have here.
Okay. It seems that we have another Baal symbol here, written in Ogham. And this is much bigger than the one we looked at a while ago, this being B and L. And what's striking also about this is in the front, it's a pretty good case that this is a libation pool and a groove where they poured blood or wine or whatever they were sacrificing. And you have to wonder about these holes also drilled here, if they were receiving some kind of offering. And there's a good case also that this is a phallic symbol, which goes with the Baal worship engraved right here.
Isn't it possible also, Jim, that, I mean, just saying a possibility, these are three distinct drilled holes. With this compass, we see we're pointing north and south, so naturally it's pointing toward that sun, which could give a sacrificial date with this alignment that they sacrificed on that particular day. Just a possibility in passing. Interesting. What?
And the rising sun was also significant with the Baal worship, wasn't it?
Yes, it was. Yes, it was. It would seem that the solstice was, you know, all men had to live, and naturally when spring came, that's when the harvest and the food was brought in, and that was the time certainly that there are certain religious beliefs and what have you were exercised on those specific occasions. It would seem that even in the temples and old Mexico and other places that there the alignments are very important in their worship and the seasons.
Now this directional marker here gave us a lot of headaches. You know, when you was here before, we were speculating about what it was, and we thought that it was a winter solstice and equinox, and as it turns out, this is a marker pointing out the day of Beltane, the sunrise on the Celtic May Day. It looks like you've got a short sword laid down here and traced. And then this directional marker is laid out on that. This line and this line points north and south. And when you make this a triangle with equal sides, this points right to the Celtic May Day.
Wow.
And right here is the fertility symbol of the Mother Goddess that's also associated with the Baal worship.
Wasn't there one of these found in this area, the statuette of the Mother Goddess?
We found the statue of the Mother Goddess just a few miles from here on an eastern slope. It's called a petromanic, free-form, slightly sculpted trunk of a woman. It probably weighs 150 to 200 pounds.
Well, maybe you could share and show that to
us. Okay, we'd be glad to do that.
Great.
There's a strong possibility that this cross here has got a Latin inscription to it. Soter in Greek has the sigma at the beginning like this, and at the end of a word you would have it like this, but in Latin this would be Salvatore Jesus.
The Savior Christ.
The Savior Christ, or Jesus. And this right here, some people may confuse it with the Baal symbol, but this is Greek. This is the pi, and this is the iota. And I like to think that it means Jesus the rock. Iesus, what is the Greek for rock?
Petros.
The interesting thing about this, these